Hello everybody, and welcome to Ancient Architects. If you follow my channel, you'll have seen over the past few weeks that I have taken a closer look at the Sphinx, as well as the origins of dynastic Egyptian history. The subject of early Egypt is huge, and even when I uploaded my latest video, I knew that my ideas would no doubt develop as I learn more, but I didn't think they would develop quite so quickly, because what I think I have discovered is the first ever depiction of the Great Sphinx, and it has been hiding in plain sight for years. Before I show you the image, I need to frame it and put it into context, because by itself, it isn't as clear as the image of the Sphinx we know so well today, and we have to think somewhat differently. The art of ancient Egypt, as well as the civilization as a whole, has developed considerably through the dynasties, and although the full, excavated view of the Sphinx is clear for us all to see today, nobody knows with any certainty what it looked like in pre-dynastic times. I have looked at the evidence for the argument about what the head of the Sphinx was before the human head was carved, whether a lion or a jackal. Over the course of my last two videos, I have said that I believe it was a lion, and looking at the geology of the area, I placed the Sphinx construction to around 3500 BC. Robert Schock believes it could be far older, and although I personally doubted it, of course this hypothesis could be true, and I have watched his recent interview with Joe Rogan with great interest. Of course, we don't have a clear historical picture of the Sphinx through the ages, and Schock's hypothesis of a pre-9700 BC date for the Sphinx is very likely. I assumed that a Sphinx that old would be more greatly weathered, but if the body had been covered over with sand for thousands of years, it could certainly have been protected from the extreme weather during the African humid period. Maybe it is 7 to 12,000 years old. Nobody can obviously know for sure. What I am sure about is that the Sphinx predates the Great Pyramid, and I am sure that it predates the unification of Upper and Lower Egypt at around 3100 BC. I strongly believe that the Sphinx was the work of another culture, local to Lower Egypt in the north, who had their own set of beliefs before the Horus kings of Egypt conquered them and removed evidence of their existence, leaving only the majestic Sphinx monument behind. Everybody seems to be in mutual agreement that the head of the Sphinx was recarved in dynastic history, and due to the style of headdress on the monument, this could have been done as early as the late Old Kingdom or later in the Middle Kingdom. I have concerned myself with the question of what it was recarved from, and although many people have placed themselves in the lion or Anubis camp, there were a few people that believe that it may have always been a human head. I scoffed at such an idea, as this just doesn't work for me. But it is I, as well as researchers such as Hancock, Boval, West and Temple, that have made the assumption that the head was once that of an animal to match the body, when we don't really know this with any certainty. I have searched through reams of ancient Egyptian art, looking for images that are without question depicting the Sphinx, and although there are many recumbent lions and jackals, we do not know that they are actually depicting the Sphinx itself. This, again, is another assumption. I then stumbled on this story that was carried by tabloid newspapers and alternative history websites of a possible UFO on the back of the Sphinx, painted on an ancient papyrus. Now, I don't need to go into detail as to why this interpretation is clearly wrong, but looking at the picture, what is clear is that the so-called UFO is actually an ancient Egyptian lotus fan, which is somewhat of an oddity in my opinion. The Egyptian fan is often associated with nobility, and a fan bearer often accompanied the king. On the ceremonial mace head of the pre-dynastic King Scorpion, the fan emblem appears behind him, and some say it signifies a divine presence. In the tomb of Tutankhamun, there is the famous golden ceremonial fan, as well as one that was made of ostrich feathers. Although fans offer a practical purpose in shielding the king from the sun and providing a cool breeze, the sunshade appearing behind the ruler in art has been interpreted as indicating that the pharaoh was endowed with characteristics of a god. It was symbolic. But the fan in question wasn't for a king. It is depicted on the back of an enormous stone monument. Like its association with the pharaohs, again the fan displayed here is clearly symbolic. In this picture, the fan is a lotus flower, known as a lotiform fan, imitating the leaves of a blue lotus flower, which was commonly associated with the River Nile in Upper Egypt, which, confusingly, is in the south. The lotus flower has many interpretations, including being the symbol of the sun, creation, rebirth and regeneration, but it was also the symbol of Upper Egypt, as well as being associated with a number of gods. They are strongly associated with one god in particular, known as Hepi or Happy. Happy is the water god, god of the River Nile, of fertility, providing water, food, and the yearly inundation of the Nile. The annual flooding of the Nile was said to be the arrival of Happy. He was also known as Lord of the Fishes and Birds of the Marshes. Without Happy, Egypt would never have prospered, and so sometimes it was even more important than the sun god Ra. Some say he was, at one time, the most worshipped god in all of Egypt. Happy is portrayed with green or blue skin, representing water, and wore a false beard. He is one of the oldest ancient Egyptian gods, traced into pre-dynastic times. The word Happy is also believed to have been the pre-dynastic name for the River Nile. He was mentioned in the pyramid texts where he was to send the river into the underworld from certain caverns, where he was thought to have lived at the first cataract. The Nile was thought to have flowed from the primeval waters of Nun, through the land of the dead, the heavens, and finally flowing into Egypt, where it rose out of the ground between two mountains. But before these dynastic pyramid texts, there were in fact two Happy deities. One in northern Lower Egypt, known as Hap-Riset, adorned with the papyrus plants of the north, and one in southern Upper Egypt, known as Hap-Met, adorned with the south's water lily or lotus flower. In dynastic times, the two deities were depicted together, often as twins, and are seen in art tying the plants of the north and south together, as seen carved onto the side of the Colossi of Memnon, symbolizing the union of Upper and Lower Egypt. Happy, therefore, is an ancient god, worshipped by pre-dynastic people of the north and south, and both versions of the gods lived on through the dynastic era. This picture of the Sphinx is part of a much larger image, and it is possible that it has both celestial and earthly meaning. From an earthly perspective, in front of the Sphinx is Horus riding a boat, showing there is water in front of the Sphinx, and this is confirmed by the god Happy, in front of Horus with green skin, lying down and representing the Nile. Khnum is also present, one of the earliest dynastic Egyptian gods associated with the Nile River. At this time in history, I would assume that all of the characters in this image had celestial and mythological connotations, but this image is also portraying Giza and specifically the Nile. It shows explicitly that the Sphinx has an association with the Nile and its god Happy. The Sphinx is, of course, located on the banks of the Nile, but lions and jackals, whichever interpretation you believe, are not symbolic of water. Also, as the lotus is a symbol of the southern ancient Egyptian cultures, it is also somewhat out of place on the Sphinx at Giza. There are even more depictions of the Sphinx with a lotus fan on its back, and I cannot seem to find a good enough explanation as to why it is there, with most researchers opting for it being a divine symbol, hence the association, but never going into more detail of why it is associated with the Sphinx. But then I had a thought. What if the Sphinx was an ancient lion from 9700 BC, as Robert Schock proposes, and was rediscovered covered in sand with just a badly eroded head of some sort protruding from a stone platform through the sand, as seen in these photographs before it was re-excavated in more modern times? What if the new face carved onto the monument isn't a pharaoh at all, but is in actual fact a god, maybe a depiction of the Nile god Happy? The monument may look as though it stares out towards the horizon, and we assume that it was associated with the heavens, and maybe it was 10,000 years ago, but it is also facing the River Nile, and before it migrated, it was located on the banks of the river. Furthermore, at the point where these fans protrude from the Sphinx in ancient Egyptian art, on the monument itself, there is a deep and seemingly empty shaft. Are we seeing an incomplete monument? Is there a missing fan-like structure that slotted into the back socket as seen in the art of the Egyptians? Was this fan present physically on the Sphinx? A stone or wooden structure perhaps? There are many recumbent lion and jackal statues and carvings found in Egyptian art, but there are very few actual known depictions of the Sphinx itself from ancient times. But when we do find them, they are often shown with an enormous lotus fan extending from its back. When all of this information sunk in, I came up with a hypothesis that if the early dynastic Egyptians, the conquerors from Upper Egypt, didn't know that the Sphinx was a dog or a lion, then maybe they didn't know there was a huge carved body under the sand. If I am looking for the earliest image of the Sphinx in Egyptian art, maybe it would look very different to how we picture it today. By all accounts, it wasn't even first excavated until late into the Old Kingdom, when the first restoration project took place. If Shock is right and the Sphinx is thousands of years older than current history says, what if the Sphinx body had been buried for thousands of years, and the old weathered lion head was all that was poking out of the sand by the time that Giza was resettled by the migrating tribes in pre-dynastic times? An old eroded monumental lion head on the banks of the river could well have been recarved into a human head by pre-dynastic people to honour their most important ancient water god, the god of the Nile River, Hapi, to look out over the Nile, at a time when water was becoming increasingly important due to North African desertification. So, with all this in mind, looking at the Sphinx conundrum in a different way, is there an early depiction of the Sphinx in ancient Egyptian art? We know that Hapi was a pre-dynastic god in both Upper and Lower Egypt, but if the Sphinx monument was dedicated to Hapi in pre-dynastic times, this would have been before the unification of Egypt, and therefore this Sphinx would not have a lotus flower fan on its back, but one made from the papyrus plant, which was the symbol of Hapi for the northern cultures. Only recently, I had been looking closely at what is arguably the most incredible piece of ancient Egyptian art ever made, the amazing Narmer palette, which is believed to show either the literal or symbolic unification of Upper and Lower Egypt. On one side, Narmer is displayed larger than life, wearing the crown of southern Upper Egypt, smiting his enemy, believed to be a leader from Lower Egypt. This side of the Narmer palette is all about his conquest, about overpowering the north. If the Sphinx, and the pyramids too for that matter, were already apparent in the north, then Narmer would have surely portrayed these powerful symbols on his palette, which dates back to around 3100 BC. To the right of Narmer, there is a strange human head extending from some kind of platform, with a fan of papyrus stalks extending from its flat back. A falcon is above, portrayed with a human hand, and is holding a rope that extends from the strange figure's nose. This is showing that Horus, symbolic of Narmer, the Horus king of Egypt from the south, has overpowered it. But what is it? For Horus to be holding it captive, it must have been an important symbol of Lower Egypt. It was clear to me that this must be the Sphinx, the largest, most iconic monument of Lower Egypt. On the Narmer palette, there is, in my opinion, the earliest depiction of the Sphinx in history, a claim that even I find somewhat troubling, but it has to be. The face of the Sphinx is the same, although not identical, as the face of the Lower Egyptian prisoner that Narmer is smiting. Therefore, this face shows that the Sphinx is associated with Lower Egypt, and has been conquered by Horus, and hence, Narmer. From its back extends not a lotus fan, but six papyrus fans, which was the symbol for the Nile god Hapreset, in pre-dynastic times in Lower Egypt. In this hypothesis, I'm assuming that the body, the legs, the tail, and the Sphinx enclosure itself were unknown, buried beneath the sand at the time Narmer became king of all Egypt. And so this image on the Narmer palette is exactly how you'd expect the Sphinx to look. But this means that, in pre-dynastic times, the Sphinx already had a human head, and already had a fan extending from its back. It was, therefore, a powerful depiction of the Lower Egypt water god Hapi. This explains why we see the Hapi fan extending from the back of the Sphinx in later dynastic history, because before it was dug out from the sand, before anybody knew it had the body of a lion or a jackal, it was in fact the Nile god Hapi. I would suggest that the face was recarved or worked once again in the Old Kingdom to reflect the dynastic portrayal of Hapi, and the Lower Egypt papyrus fan on its back was replaced with the Upper Egypt lotus fan, as used by the dynastic race. Therefore, the Nile god was still honoured, but the monument was adapted by the conquerors from the south. There is so much work to be done, but I wanted to share this hypothesis with you whilst I'm working through it. When you look at this image of the Sphinx from later dynastic history, then look at how the Sphinx looks when covered with sand, and then look at the depiction on the Narmer palette, could this really be the Sphinx? Personally, I honestly think it could be. In this video, I've tried to provide some context around my hypothesis. It would mean that the Sphinx, in actual fact, probably was an ancient lion, carved by an unknown civilization, and it could well be thousands of years old, as Hancock Boval, West, and Schock believe. I can concede that Robert Schock, and not Colin Reader, is probably right in his hypothesis. As time went by, the Sphinx was covered with sand, as conditions became more arid. The ancient people of the western desert would have migrated towards the Nile with the onset of desertification from around 3500 BC, and I am suggesting that these people didn't carve the Sphinx in its totality, as I originally believed, but found an old eroded lion head poking out of the ground facing the river. I believe they refashioned this head into a representation of their all-important Nile god Hapi and adorned it with his sacred plant, the papyrus. Papyrus plants can grow up to 16 feet high, and so it is possible that the pre-dynastic people created the shaft in the back of the stone monument to insert the stems, decorating the monument in honour of the Nile god, hence the image we see on the Narmer palette. Whatever happened next in the history of the Sphinx is open to yet more discussion, but I now have my own hypothesis for its prehistory and its development. And if this is the earliest depiction of the Sphinx, then the Narmer palette is surely the most important piece of art from the history of ancient Egypt. Thank you very much for watching this episode of Ancient Architects. If you enjoyed the video, please subscribe to the channel, please like the video, and please leave a comment below. Thank you very much.